Okay, hi y'all. I'm very excited this evening to be here with Lukasz. He is an artist and comic creator in Poland, and I met him via our mutual comic friend, Ben Mitchell. So thank you for that introduction, Ben. Thank you for being with me today, Lukasz. I'm very excited.
Hello, hi.
I want to read one line from your bio that I read earlier. That was really great. It's stupid comics for smart people are about wrestlers, ninja, bikers, mutants, conspiracy dogs, etc., Jack Kirby believers. I found that really, that was a fun, interesting visual to kind of give people an idea who haven't seen your comics before, but I'll put a link to that as well.
it is because no one with our concentration span in 2020, no one will read about my comics, you know, the text which will be the longer, if description of my comics, of my work will be longer than one or two sentences, no one will read it.
Yeah, you know, but those are great.
You don't need to, you can't use like biography, like
yeah.
Elsewhere.
Yes, of course. Please.
Yes, no one will. Okay, great. Because I have, mm-hmm. you know, lack of my vocabulary will, you know, I if
you're
I can
fine.
Swear, it's
you're
awesome.
Fine. Please do. Hell yes.
So no one will read like fucking biography like for like few pages long. So I am also when I need someone's text about someone, I also say her, him, like just write few sentences.
Yes.
I don't want to know what contest you won or where have you been. Just, you know, the basic
it's,
stuff.
It's the age of like micro information where we have like 2 seconds attention span. So you have to,
yes.
You have to be quick. So if, that being said, please tell me briefly about who you are and what you do.
My name is Lukasz Kowalczuk. I come from Poland and I'm comics creator, professional, I think, because most of my income comes from work in comics. And this is not only drawing, this is also writing, this is also organizing convention, this is also running workshops. So a lot of different stuff that
yeah.
needs to be done in my case.
Yeah.
So I would love to just draw or just write, but some stuff needs to be done, and I'm doing all, you know, a lot of different kind of work.
Mm-hmm.
I also do illustrations. Design and other stuff.
And I understand it's you and your wife and your daughter, and you are working full time. Is that right?
Like I am working full time.
Mm-hmm.
I have a wife. I have mm-hmm. a 5-year-old daughter. She was mm-hmm. here today in the studio. she's not here, so that's why we can talk. And yes, I'm working full time.
Mm-hmm.
I have a studio outside of my
mm-hmm.
flat.
Okay.
We live in a 2-room flat.
Okay.
And
you're in northern
precise,
Poland, right?
Yeah, and to
yeah.
be in northern Poland, and to, mm-hmm. to be precise, when someone from UK will tell you 2 rooms
mm-hmm.
flat,
mm-hmm.
It doesn't. It means that they also have a living room.
Oh, right.
Like 3 rooms. But
yeah.
if someone in Poland tells you that he or she lives
mm-hmm.
in 2 rooms flat, it means 2 rooms, not more. Like so
right.
we live in two rooms flat. I work in studio in our local library.
Okay.
I have kind of deal with them. I work for the library. I do workshops and
okay.
I organize annual comic convention, Rumia Comic Con.
Yes.
And I sometimes help them with like what comics should we buy. So I
okay.
And that's all. So it's
cool.
it's generally exchange. I don't pay for my studio, but I do some work for them. And I have full-time access to the place. I would show it, but I have laptop and monitors here.
So yes. Yeah. No.
So I can't. Anyway, yes. The whole colorful sheet is taken from my house, from my flat, which was too small for me, my wife and my daughter. So I was also looking for a place that I can place all this stuff, like action figures, like comics, games. We have like old TV set.
Cool.
Actually two TV sets, like one is with old Nintendo, the bigger one has PlayStation 2. So this is kind of also kind of man cave.
Yeah.
But when you work here, like I'm coming here to work, after 8, 9, or 10 hours of work, I just want to go, you know, home.
Yeah.
Go back home and spend time with my family.
Yeah.
And this is work with, like, I have some kind of work ethics, some kind of work hygiene.
Yes.
And I'm trying not to, I could spend more time here, but I'm trying not to work more than 8 or 9 hours per day.
Right.
It is difficult, but it's also very important.
Yes, I think I sometimes need my own studio because I work from home either in the bedroom or the kitchen. And I'm basically, it is 11 o'clock at night here. this is kind of a project more than work, but yes, it's a funny thing, work and where you do it and how it affects your productivity.
Yeah, and I can sleep here, so that's cool. Oh,
cool. In case of an emergency.
I can like, you know, crash on kind of there is a dimbak. It's not a bed, so I can like half of a take a nap when I'm really tired or I just need a break. So
yeah.
That's cool. And I have, you know, the whole library, like
a few doors
later. This is not kind of open space. This is my place.
Yeah.
And earlier there was a kind of book club, discussion club.
Yeah.
Here. Uh-huh. But they are meeting only once in a month after my work. So they don't. Yeah. I'm not bothered. And now during the pandemic they are meeting, but not in such small place. They need a bigger. Like, you know, the distance and all the stuff. I worked this year because of pandemic, because of quarantine, because of lockdown. I worked for like 2 months in home, and it wasn't because I couldn't work here, but because this is a separated place. I have a distance. I could work here. But I wanted to spend time with my family because Helena and Dasha couldn't go outside, like everywhere they wanted to go, and spending the whole time in home in 2 rooms flat with 5-year-old kids.
Yeah.
It's hard. So I tried for 2 months to work in home, and hopefully I don't want to say that never again, but it wasn't easy.
I think it's when you have a small child, I think that, you know, I don't have kids, and I think that it's my pandemic experience is very different for anyone who either lives by themselves or has small children. I think it's just a completely different type of world. You kind of led into my next question, which is, you worked from home for 2 months during the pandemic. You said that the Rumia Comic Con was the last comic convention that happened before lockdown. So maybe you could just talk to me about what your life was like before the lockdown, and just and also personally, professionally, and also from like a Polish perspective, how have things changed?
The main work-wise, the main difference is that we don't have conventions. We don't have conventions, we don't have festivals, everything is postponed, everything is cancelled this year. The biggest festival in Łódź, which was going to be in September in Łódź, is going to be a virtual one. Virtual. I have like Transylvanian accent, so.
You're fine. You're great. I love it. It's good.
This is the main difference, that you can't just go to the other side of country and meet people.
Yeah.
Before the pandemic, it was, as I like to say, business as usual. I went to Katowice. I went to Wrocław. These are like 600 kilometers, 350 miles distances. It is quite a lot for Poland, because this isn't as big country as Australia or United States.
Mm-hmm.
However, it is opposite side of country. So it is like 6-7 hours by train. So I was this year I was in Katowice as a guest of Comics Festival in Wrocław. We managed to do Rumia Comic Con, and then week after, everything stopped. Lockdown, pack off, staying home, nothing.
Right.
So, and in my case, it was like, okay, I will try. After the Rumia Comic Con, the first week I was still working in studio. Then I decided to change the place and go to the main library building because of some safety matters, because my studio is in the part, the library is actually, I will write, the library is in the building of train station.
Okay.
They even won the prize, the Rumia library won the prize of the most beautiful library worldwide, like few years ago. So
this cool.
Yeah, this is famous. Ah. I'm in the, but I'm in the part of building that is, more that belongs to railways.
Okay.
So I have the toilet. We have the same toilet as the security, etc.
Okay.
So I figure out that some sort of safety measures will be okay. I spent week working in the main building, and then I just decided to go home because of general lockdown to spend time with my family. And likewise, this is the main difference. People can't, publishers, creators, they can't sell their shit at the conventions.
Yeah.
We can't meet with the readers. With our friends. So this is the most. I was going to do less conventions and less festivals, because economic wise it wasn't good. It was good to meet friends, but the travels and the costs and and income wasn't that good.
Mm-hmm.
And lockdown came, and it happens like forever.
You were forced to do that. So you were thinking
it is not my decision. I'm forced to do that.
At
the beginning of lockdown, people were still buying stuff, books, buying comics.
Yeah.
But then later it kind of collapsed.
Right.
I don't know what's going on now exactly on the book market.
I
know that there is a lot of, I know that there is still a lot of deals, good deals, like you can buy a shitload of books, shitload of comics online.
Okay, that's good.
Because publishers need to have some income.
Yeah, sure.
And we have really sick and corrupted system of book pricing. If you are going to festival in Poland, never mind. Book one, comics one, the price on the cover, you won't ever pay the price on the cover.
Okay.
It's always a discount.
Okay, right.
So when we publish the book, it is like, okay, the price will be, let's say, 50 zlotys on the cover.
Yeah.
I already know that we will sell it for 35.
Right. Right.
Seven, because it will be already discounted. It is a matter yeah. of, you know, it's a long story.
But it's so frustrating, I think, for creative people. I mean, just this part, this pandemic all over the world, anyone who's producing and creating, it's just not good.
The beginning was very hard because some stuff was cancelled. And for example, one comic book that I worked on for like almost 2 years, in some time periods, were going to be published in, I think, April or May worldwide distribution. But I had, you know, I was paid by, you know, the page rate was paid, so I was okay with it. Okay, it's postponed, all right. But still, it's a pity. Mm. And first few weeks were quite hard.
Yeah.
In my case, yes?
I was just wondering.
Go
ahead.
In my case, the work system, despite the home office thing, didn't change a lot because I usually work with people from outside Poland. I do comics for people from outside Poland.
Yeah.
Even if I work for people from Poland, I don't have to meet them.
Yes.
Which is great.
Yeah.
I don't have to waste time for like meetings, like face to face.
Yeah.
So it's all based online. It's all based on online contact. So it didn't change a lot. The first month was quite hard because there was an anxiety, uncertainty. Yeah. But then, surprise, I found some new clients. I started to work like the projects were just, you know, coming in. And I can say that I wasn't so busy in years. So, it's okay for me. But also, I don't know how long it will last.
Yeah, yeah.
We don't know nothing.
Yes, that's one of the hardest things I think about it is you just can only plan for your day and the next day and that's about it. Now, were the lockdowns really strict in Poland? Were they like, did everything close and stuff like that? Or, yeah? Okay.
Yes, groceries, the basic stuff was open, the shops. Shops with groceries were open. There was a time when shopping malls were closed.
Right.
So we did like groceries once in a week, and that was basically all. The whole libraries, museums, venues like for gigs, for live concerts. It was all closed. The professional sport was postponed, which is quite good because, for example, Polish Football League is shit. So there was some good thing about clones and all the stuff. I of course I'm kidding because it's a lot of people had lower income.
Yeah.
And a lot of people were go out of business. Whatever they did. So imagine someone opening restaurant in February.
In the pandemic, I know.
Fine.
Yeah.
Worldwide. Well,
So Poland is ranked currently 44th in the world for COVID-19 with 59,000 cases and nearly 2,000 deaths. This is just a few minutes ago. I checked that. Do you know anyone who's had it? From the health side of things?
But this is, I don't know anyone personally, but the circle of people is getting smaller and smaller each month, each week. Like a few months ago, I didn't know anyone who knows anyone who were sick. Mm-hmm. But now I know people who know people, like my close friends know people who are sick.
Yeah.
Who were going through the COVID. I believe that it is somewhere, it is near. This kind of question is interesting because anti-maskers and anti-vacciners use it like, do you know anyone who's sick?
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know anyone. And I'm like, did you heard about AIDS? HIV?
Yeah.
Do you know anyone with AIDS?
Yeah.
No, but they didn't see economy like that.
Yeah. People, are so vulnerable for conspiracy theories right now. I mean, it's just because of the uncertainty. I think they're looking for something to believe in sometimes. Do people?
Yes, of course.
Yeah. Do people wear masks in Poland? Do you see a lot of people wearing masks when you go out?
Yes. Yes. Yeah? We wear masks. For example, in library, it is obligatory to wear masks.
Right.
If you won't wear masks, you won't be able to. Take some books.
So they will refuse service, right?
You won't be serviced. Most of we wear masks indoors.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, during the time, months later, it's not as restricted.
Yeah.
I wear mask when I go to shop.
Yeah.
I see people who don't wear it, but I'm also kind of like, okay, this is them. I don't care about them.
Yeah.
All we can do is, you know, all I can do is not to be asshole and I will wear a mask. I know people who don't wear masks, who like the really strange theories.
Yeah.
And it's kind of, at this stage, I don't care because I don't even try to understand them.
Yeah.
It's like, okay, just, you know, it's your choice. And I know that it's the wearing mask, even people who work in shops, in restaurants, there are more and more places where it's not that restricted.
Right.
They won't tell you, like, I won't service you because you don't wear mask. Because it's really like now, before possible second wave or third wave or second lockdown, it's really not that tightened.
Right.
When you will go to big shopping mall, when you will go to bigger grocery store, most of people, I think that 95-99% people are still wearing masks.
Okay, that's good. And so it's funny, so it's becoming a bit less restricted, but you're not completely sure which part of the wave you're in, but there's still...
You don't know how to act.
Yeah.
That's the biggest problem, because this is the first situation like that.
Yeah, yeah.
But, you know, worst case scenario, if it is some kind of hoax, worst case scenario, it will be that I wore a mask for four months.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
Yeah.
I can live with that.
Yeah.
But I assume that it is all truth.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
I can live with that, but it's not so restricted now.
Yeah.
And I'm afraid that this kind of attitude approach can cost us. Again, like some kind of second wave, third wave.
Of course, of course.
I just try not to think about.
Yeah, it's one day at a time.
Much.
Yeah. Is it good? See, I was telling you, I know I've been doing a bit of reading about Poland. You've been in the news quite a lot. Your country has over the past few weeks. But do they have good healthcare? Is it good healthcare in Poland?
We do have basic healthcare.
Okay.
Obligatory basic healthcare.
So if everyone has access to it.
Yes, everyone has access to healthcare. I'm not an expert in this matter. I had all.
Of course.
If you are working, you have a healthcare. You pay. Your insurance is paid. Like if you work. If you are hired.
Mm-hmm.
You pay for the healthcare.
Okay.
It's not like you don't pay and you have it, like it is obligatory. It is like when I'm working at some place, I signed the contract.
Mm-hmm.
The healthcare that the people that hire me pay certain amount of money.
Okay.
And if you are running company, if you are running company, you are like self-employed, you are paying certain amount of healthcare, which is obligatory for you to pay.
Okay.
This is kind of big controversy over the year, because a lot of people say that they would manage better without it. I doubt it, but it's the common problem.
Right.
So we do have the basic healthcare. I am insured. I have insurance. My wife has insurance. My daughter has insurance.
Mm-hmm.
As long as you are till 18 years till 18 years old, you don't pay for the insurance. You are insured by default.
Right.
And I did therapy because I was addicted. I had a problem with alcohol, drugs. So I did like 2 years therapy, even longer than 2 years, and it was paid from the taxes.
That's great.
If someone from Poland is listening to this and has some doubts about national healthcare, it's like you paid for my therapy.
That's fascinating. That's great.
Not every sector of healthcare is as well organized as that kind of therapy.
Right. Sure. But even
I think it is kind of Polish. If I will have broken, Satan forbid, I hope not, or arm broken, if I will have some kind of accident, I am going to hospital and I don't pay the bill. Yeah.
Okay. No matter, even if you're unemployed,
unemployed, it can be a problem.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
Then it is a problem. So this is how it works. You pay the price, the monthly price. Never mind if you are sick or not. You pay for this is kind of social. I think it's a matter of it is kind of social. Social security, social solidarity as well.
Yeah. Right.
I can pay for other people health insurance. I don't have a problem with that.
Yeah.
Really.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's how it works. But I wouldn't call it like. Of course, there are people who will say that this is like socialism and. They will manage without it. Just give us our money and we will have our, you know, we'll pay for our insurance and we'll manage. It is not perfect. The national health security is not perfect by any means.
There is
a lot of problems with that.
But
also I wouldn't exchange it for a system like in United States.
That's the
bottom line. It is not our so-called NHS is not perfect, but I wouldn't exchange it for something else at the moment.
Right, of course. So that's interesting. So they can, if you're unemployed, there can still be financial difficulties, but when you are employed, even if you are not sick, everyone who is employed pays for healthcare for everyone, right?
There are certain amounts of money that need to be paid monthly.
This is
kind of fund. It's also the thing with managing this kind of huge budget.
That's
the biggest problem, because we do, as the citizens of this country, we feel that this money isn't managed properly.
Yeah.
And the same goes with the money from our taxes, because we pay taxes.
Well,
And yeah. we pay, it's like you are working, you pay taxes,
yeah,
and you pay the health insurance. That's
right.
That's the two biggest things. And many yeah. people will say that these are obstacles.
Okay. Interesting. And that leads me to kind of my next question. So I know that in Australia and in the United States, there was a bit of money given to citizens when the pandemic hit. Did that happen in Poland? Were people who were unemployed that you were talking about earlier, did they get any financial assistance from the government?
I don't know about that kind of assistance because I have work.
Okay, right.
So
yeah.
I don't know exactly how
sure.
was it. Do know about the people who the companies mm-hmm. and self-employed people who yeah. are like one person companies
mm-hmm.
They didn't have to pay.
Some of the stuff that
would be paid for in normal situation outside,
right.
you know, not in pandemic. So it was right. like few months of not, you know, they didn't have to.
Yeah,
anyway,
right.
I know that some people call it handouts, but I won't call it our because it's not my government. I don't like government
yeah.
at all.
Yeah.
But they do have programs like 500 plus,
uh-huh.
which means that if you have a kid,
yeah,
they pay you 500 zlotys monthly.
Okay. Interesting.
Which is like.
This is before the pandemic. Yeah, this is
before the pandemic.
Right, right.
And
okay.
This is like short before the pandemic. They started to pay it to people who have one kid also, like
okay.
us.
Yeah.
So
everyone.
So everyone. Yeah. If
with
you
one
have
kid.
Like five kids. Yeah. If you have five kids, it's like 2,500 zlotys. Yes, but this is kind of
per month.
Is kind of we call it. It is helping.
Okay, yeah,
it is helping, but it is also a situation when if you have like five kids and you have like this 2,500 zlotys, you won't go to, there is no way if you are living in the poor mm-hmm. kind of country, in some small town or village, you basically won't go to work because no one will pay you 2,500 zlotys. And
wow, and that's per month, is that correct? That you can
this
get
is
it
per month, but
right.
remember that this is but there is the other side of
yeah,
other side of other there is the other side of this one because everything is getting more and more expensive,
because of the
prices getting higher,
yeah,
and because of inflation,
yeah,
these 500 zlotys.
Becomes
like,
less and
know,
less
like
and less.
300 zlotys
yeah,
now.
Sure,
it's like
sure.
250 or something. So
that's so, it's very interesting. It's also interesting because before we started recording, you were mentioning you described Poland as a second world country.
Yes,
it is.
We are like second league. No one
right.
Honestly,
right.
no one cares about Poland. Like USA, it is a good place. It is a good place to. For United States, it is a good place, like parking lot for their, you know, for their rockets that they
yeah.
can, you know, move towards Russia.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
And for
yeah.
Russia, is like we are like a pimple on the earth. So it's
yeah. But at the same
yeah.
time, maybe it's, and you're a member of the European Union. But at the same time, it's funny because it seems like yeah, maybe people don't think about it, or you're second tier. I don't or. A second world, but you have some, it sounds like there are some policies that are concerned about people's welfare, and
mm-hmm.
but then again, also I want, and I'm conscious because I don't want to take a lot of your time, Lukasz, but I'm also curious because of course also in the news, and it's funny, there's kind of towards the end that I'm bringing this up, but there's been a lot of protesting about the election being rigged. I've been reading about like LGBT rights in Poland, and
uh-huh.
and so it's like some of these things you've described seem quite benevolent, or maybe not extremely benevolent, but like generous. But then it sounds like there's some other potentially human rights issues going on as well?
Of course, yeah. Yes, they are. Like I mentioned this 500 plus program because you asked about
the,
about some programs that, our government provides. Yeah. The truth is, we have Catholic. I won't say far right because it's hard to say, because by far right I understand shit like Ku Klux Klan, not our government.
Yeah.
This is far right for me.
Okay.
Like terrorist organization like Combat 18 or Blood and Honor.
Right.
As someone who spent a few years on hardcore punk scene, I guess I know some stuff about right wing.
Okay.
But anyway, we have a Catholic right wing government.
Okay.
There are some atrocious policies about LGBTQ and the fact that they are treating LGBTQ as a kind of, not as people, but as, not as people, but as kind of worldview.
Right.
As kind of, I don't know, party as kind of something that you can, you know, sign in.
Okay.
Like the misconception of Antifa.
Right. Right.
Like
okay.
So I can't figure out, but there there are some policies.
Mm-hmm.
This country is fairly intolerant. I think that this intolerance, the racism and homophobia is still here.
Uh-huh. I didn't realize it was Catholic, so you think it's kind of a Catholic influence?
It is Catholic. It is also because of Catholic bringing, because of our version of Taliban.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Catholic Taliban.
Okay.
It's hard to, you know, it's hard to describe in few sentences, but
Of course,
I think that of course you won't, you know, you will it is hard topic, because I also think that as a white heterosexual guy, I'm not the right person to speak in the name of gay people.
Of course. But I mean,
you know what I mean. But
yeah.
But there is a it is still a problem here. We don't have ethnic minorities. We are the majority of country is white Slavic people.
Uh-huh. Okay? Right. Okay.
So but there is also kind of so people are looking for some kind of enemy.
Mm-hmm.
For some kind of group that they can that they can fear.
Interesting. Right.
That people are looking for someone to blame,
right?
For a scapegoat,
yeah.
And LGBTQ community is perfect, but also when Poland opened it as a European Union country, when Poland opened it, the borders with Ukraine, we also have a lot of people from Ukraine who are working here.
Right.
And they are the same race. So until you will talk with them, you don't know if someone is from Ukraine, actually. So
Right, yeah.
And this is also the hate is also they also get the fair share of the, you know,
of looking for someone to hate. Yeah.
I don't want to say that Poland is a country when, you know, I'm, like I said, I am heterosexual, I am straight, white, male. I won't be bothered on the street.
Yeah.
And I'm going, you know, when I'm going on my Sunday dinner with my family, okay?
Yeah.
So I can't say, I can't say too much about this kind of hate, but it is here, it is somewhere, it is in our elders.
You were saying, I think I was reading, aren't there parts of Poland that are like gay free zones or something like that?
These are not parts that there is no It is it can be, imagine that it can be sanctioned by local authorities.
Right.
That, you know, you have the board that this is a city.
So this, they will say things like, this is a...
And there are stickers like, this is LGBTQ free zone. And local authorities don't do anything with that.
Okay.
They don't say nothing against it.
Right.
And,
okay.
It is a problem. But also it is a kind of problem that that is discussed, that is protested now, on higher scale.
Well, it was making national news. I mean, or international news.
I also hope that this kind of attitude, this kind of hate, this, you know, the racism, the homophobia, it is slowly. I hope that this is kind of. I need to check out this. I need to check how to say it, because this idiom that that is. It is kind of swan singing.
Swan song.
I hope it is some kind of swan song, that it is like last gasp, but I hope and hope won't, you know, won't make this, it won't make this thing go away. I'm not.
Of course.
I'm not acting. Okay, please.
No. I mean, it's interesting. I want to just, and also, I want to make sure I understand. So people might say, the local authorities might say, this is a LGBTQ free zone, but it's not like law enforcement is actually like checking to make sure.
It's not like Nazi Germany. It's not this level of
it's more like hateful words and stuff like
it's
that
more
and
like, yeah. yes it's more like yeah. it's more like hateful words it's more mm-hmm. like it's more like general it's more like general attitude of people okay. in some parts of country it is worse in some kind of country it is better.
Right.
Probably
right.
You won't see this. You won't see too much of these stickers in centers of big, you know.
Of course.
Cities.
Yeah.
You
yeah.
You will see it in smaller towns.
Is this?
Is
this relevant to like what is happening? So the other thing I'm reading is that a lot of people are protesting because of this homophobia, but also people are protesting because people don't believe the local elections are accurate. A guy was in power for the last 26 years and they don't, I think it was 26 years.
I think that you will need to make some cuts because you are talking about Belarus.
Talking about who?
You are talking about other country. You are talking about Belarus.
Is that not Poland?
No.
Please. Okay. Is that near Poland?
It is neighboring country.
Okay.
It is like United States and Canada. So.
All right. No. That's good to know. No. I'm happy to leave that in there because that can show like that my own kind of ignorance in that way. You know, because I was.
It is Belarus.
These are two
different countries.
We did have
elections here.
Okay.
They were like president elections, and they were in May.
Okay.
Took place in May.
Yeah.
And there is a problem with elections. I didn't vote for years because of there was no government in Poland after 1990 that I could say that was trustful or good.
Okay.
And I had this feeling that nothing will change it. I grew up a little bit, so I'm voting for like last, I don't know, five or six elections I voted. Even if I didn't have someone to vote for, I voted, but I'm tired of the situation when I need to vote for a guy or gal who I disagree less.
Yes, you know, of course.
I disagree less with the other guy. I think that a lot of people in United States now this kind of situation with Biden and Harris.
It was that way, I think, as well with Clinton and Trump as well, the lesser of two evils.
It didn't work. Yeah. Last time. And now United States in a deep shit. I think that there is no scale. You know what people say in Poland? When we talk about politics, it's like, I heard it a few times, and it's like we say that it's bad. We have this kind of shitty government. We have this kind of bad decisions, etc., etc. We don't have no one to vote for, but it could also be as bad. Don't worry, it could be like in United States. We could have like this kind of clown as a president.
It can always get worse.
The scale is so big that I think that clown is not a good word, because there are some good clowns. But if we are talking about Belarus, it's like there is Belarus, there is stuff happening in Thailand, in Hong Kong,
everywhere.
We are living in a global village, so there is Hong Kong, there is Thailand, there is Belarus, there is United States, obviously, with Black Lives Matter going on for 60 days, 70, 80, still going strong. And there is something happening, but in Belarus, their election were rigged like their last four elections were rigged.
Okay.
We didn't have rigged elections, and still the president Duda won again. He won again. We had two rounds. And in the second round, we were forced. We weren't forced. I could not go and vote, but I did vote because I don't vote only for me. It's not me.
Of course.
I don't live in kind of, you know, vacuum. I have daughter. I have wife.
Yeah.
I have, for example, I have, you know, I know LGBTQ people.
Yeah, of course.
But I knew that if this president, like current president, will lose, their lives can be a little bit better, even, you know, small change, like small fracture.
If I
can help them, I can, you know, I can go and vote, because it won't be, I don't think it will be worse, like much worse.
Yeah.
So that's the problem. But also, I have many friends who are not voting.
Okay.
Like, I understand them, because imagine the situation. I did vote for, you know, parliament election, the president election, and a few years ago I used to draw like editorial internet drawings that don't vote, it's all shit, and etc.
Oh.
They are quite popular.
Really?
Okay. Because I had this kind of attitude, like don't step into the shit, and there was like shit times with flags and the political party names on it.
Right.
But imagine the situation, like I did vote for a left-wing party called Razem Together.
Mm-hmm.
And I still kind of support them by voting, nothing more, to be honest.
Yeah, and they, of course.
Before the last parliament elections, they did coalition with post-communists, with party that is kind of. I need to check the spelling, which is. Uh, kind of which is kind of descendant of the old order, of the old before 1990 old order, you know. They are descendants of the Communist Party.
Okay.
Like the real communists.
Right.
Like not this which you will read in internet that they
are
okay.
Right.
The real hammer and sickle crew.
Okay. Okay. Which is like what is happening, like Russia?
I don't want to say my party, but the party I support, they did white left-wing coalition with fuckers like SLD, like which I hate, really, really hate.
Okay.
And they, it did happen. They did, you know, they won some place in the parliament. So like 50 seats.
Okay.
And only few of the seats were won by my party. Okay. And like, you see what they are doing, you see the tweets or whatever, you hear them on the radio, you hear the those people from SLD, and you're like, you know,
touching
your head in this belief, and you are like, okay, so I voted for those guys, I voted for those coalition. And last week or 2 weeks ago, in the middle of pandemic, in the middle of worldwide economic crisis, there was a bill in the parliament that was about raise of their income, like of parliament income, like the rise of
right. So they wanted to increase their income in the middle of the pandemic.
Yeah, deputies, MPs, deputies, legates, they wanted to increase their income, and huge majority of these people voted yes in the middle of pandemic.
Right.
And, you know, imagine that.
Yeah.
People
of
from
course.
So-called my party didn't vote for it.
Okay.
But it doesn't change anything for me.
Of course.
In my opinion, because they are in the coalition, they are with these people, they are sitting there. And to see something like that, that level of fuckery, malignant, malignant, vicious fuckery to raise, you know, to raise your salary in the middle of pandemic, which we talk about salaries that are already
quite high.
Quite high.
Right.
And outside the parliament, you had like this kind of there are protests in Belarus. There are protests against intolerance in Poland. There are protests. There are LGBTQ protests, and they try to, you know, to do it silently. But you can't do anything silent in this era.
Yeah.
So now try to say. So try to talk with people and say you need to go and vote. You need to make a change. Like try, like at least try to make a small change. And don't bark.
I know. I usually try to vote. I always vote in the big ones, and I can't wait for my ballot to come to vote in this election. It's so important, but it is frustrating because when you see something, your party might be voting against the pay rises.
It's really hard to say my party because
of course
I feel less and less supporter of this kind of group. I am very near to the point where when I will say just I don't care. I am not political active.
Yeah, of course.
I'm not an activist. I just vote.
Yes, but even is I love it that you used to make stickers telling people not to vote, and now you've kind of. That's interesting that you kind of changed
your
mind.
I did, and this was the change of attitude, the change of mind. It is really hard to, but I don't, you know what, I don't, but I don't say publicly, I don't use my platforms. I sure. don't have a big following. I would lie if I would say that people will listen to me or something. I don't use it to tell people to vote or yeah. not to vote.
Yeah.
I just keep yeah. it to my, to be honest, yeah. I just keep it to myself, mainly because of the situation, of the situations that the deputies, the people in power, they yeah. didn't, they don't, they still don't deserve our support.
Yeah.
It
yeah.
is still kind of, we still kind of give them constant credit yeah. of our yeah. trust.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
and I don't yeah. know when it will be spent. I think that when it will be spent totally, it will be second Belarus or something.
Yeah. Yeah.
But and it's, we are far from Belarus, like in terms of, you know, rigging.
Yes, and I'm so glad you clarified that. I think I was, I got confused, and I was thinking that that was happening in Poland, but Belarus is a completely different country. So that is my American ignorance, or my Alex ignorance, really.
No, I don't think that most people in America would be able to show Poland on the map.
Yeah.
But on the second, but you know, on the second thought, they wouldn't be able to show most of the countries on the map, considering the level of American education. However, this might be some kind of stereotype.
No, I remember, well, it's a stereotype, but I remember when I studied in Northern Ireland when I was like 21. And I got, and I was getting quizzed on European capitals, and I got really defensive because I didn't know a lot of them. And I said, okay, well, can you tell me the capitals of American states? And they could. And
yeah,
I was
because,
like,
I can name some of, but
yeah,
it's, you know, someone new. But we can always say that, okay, you want capitals of your states, so tell us capitals of Polish voivodeships. That's why I say that Poland is kind of second tier country,
yeah.
because we don't, yeah. as a country, we are not, despite the wet dreams of our government, wet dreams of every right-wing nationalist or so-called patriot, we will be a second-tier country for a long time, and I
yeah.
don't think that really matters.
Yeah.
I don't care. I don't really care, because this is not kind of fucking, you know, sports league.
No, and
I don't care about it. You know,
yeah.
it's like, okay, no one cares. Not you know, Poland on the scale on the earth is not the most important country. Probably we are not in first.
Yeah.
50
well,
or
it shouldn't. It shouldn't be a competition.
It shouldn't be.
Yeah.
That's the whole idea. We can be. It's like the thing about being proud
yes.
or being
yes.
ashamed of. I
yeah.
will tell you, I can be proud because of stuff I do. I did.
Of course,
and
yeah.
because of stuff, for example, my relatives will do. Someone who I have, like, if I have impact on someone, yeah? Like my daughter,
yeah.
my wife.
Yeah.
I can be proud because of them, because of myself, but also, that's also important. I can be ashamed because of my, you know, many people will say that I'm so ashamed of Polish government and of the stuff that is going on with LGBTQ community, for
yeah.
example,
yeah.
or because of corruption or because of another decision, another bill. I am not ashamed of this. I am aware of it. I am
yeah.
really sorry for some of the people, but I am not ashamed because I am not a racist. I am not homophobic. That's the thing. But I am also not proud because some guy will, you know,
yeah.
score a goal on the second side of
the court.
Of
course. Yeah.
Really.
Yeah. Yeah. I think, and it is worrisome that somehow this culture has evolved, that you either are proud or ashamed. And it's like, you know, why do we not try to just improve what we why can't you just like it or dislike it? You weren't born representing your government, right?
No, like, you know what? Government by any means, no.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
You are not even born to represent your country.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
It's
yeah.
not like I was born and I need to, you know, it is my decision.
Yeah.
It is my decision to, for example, I don't know, celebrate Independence Day.
Yeah, sure.
Celebrate some important anniversary.
Yeah.
I understand people who, it's not like I want to diss people who celebrate such stuff.
Of course, of course.
They are like, I don't know, Star Trek fandom.
Yeah.
I don't care about Star Trek. You like Star Trek? Okay. I don't care about... If you will say in public that you don't care about your flag or national symbols, it's like saying that some people will say that it's like speaking on the graves of all those people who were fighting. It's just stating the fact that I do not care. I do care about my family, my community. I do care. The last instant of my patriotism is comics. I do care about Polish comics.
Yeah.
I do care about my peers, about fellow creators from Poland.
Yeah.
I really do care. And there is a kind of competitiveness here. Like, I would really like to, you know, show the whole world that Polish comics are great. And okay, and this is kind of, you know, this is kind of Michael Jordan thing, like mindset. We really do. I really would like, and that's all.
No,
but that's I can understand some other people, but I don't want to diss them. You can be a patriot. You don't. Mm. You can be a patriot, but you don't have to.
Yeah.
It's not obligatory, for fuck's sake.
Yeah, that's a really interesting thing to think about. I think I am very, even though I am now an Australian citizen, I'm quite attached to my American identity. And I don't know if proud is the word, but because I have a lot of problems with the United States, but I believe in it. And it's interesting, the thought that you could kind of, you know, you could cut to the idea of letting some of that go a little bit, you know. I think that's an interesting concept.
It's very healthy.
I am not personally responsible for Donald Trump.
You are not personally. When I see people from states like Democrats, even not Democrats, just like people from states who didn't vote for this guy.
Yeah.
Who are like, they don't have to be ashamed of it. They don't have to be ashamed of other people who voted for Trump.
Yeah.
It's not, I don't know.
Yeah, I like that.
It's not their, you know, it's not their fault that they have kind of like this.
Yeah.
It's a matter of this final thing that you have such president, like, and we have like President Duda, or people in Belarus have Lukashenko. It's not like personal, it's not somebody's fault.
Imagine if we could all kind of separate from that, the idea that we, you know, this pride or responsibility or shame, any of that. It's not something I think about that often, but I'm definitely, it's intriguing to think about that you could let some things go, and perhaps it doesn't mean that you don't have to vote and you can't be invested in your community, but perhaps you can feel, I don't know, it might be a little bit like, a weightlifting, perhaps, you know?
You don't have to, it's not, in my opinion, it's not obligatory. That's also, that's also the problem of education system when it's being pushed. Like my daughter is 5 years old and she's in kindergarten that is a part of bigger school. So when they have some kind of anniversary, like Independence Day, etc., as 4-5 years old kids are taking a part in this kind of
the ceremony.
Yeah, the ceremonies. Yeah. I'm like, yeah, she should know something about her heritage, I think, about the tradition, about the country we live in, because we still live in this country. It's not like we have borders but what if, you know, the 10-15 years will pass and she will be more critic. Like, she will be more like, what the fuck? What, why? What for? Like, the same thing, like, we were forced to go, when I was small, I was forced to go to church. When you are forced to go to church, when you are forced to pray, this is a natural for all the kids and all the young people, that you will be against it. If religion is forced, it is a big chance that you will be, that you will
resent it.
You will force, we have a lot of atheists are coming from the, you know, Catholic families because it was forced, because it was like, you need to pray, you need to be, you know, you are baptized in most of, in most of cases, you are baptized by default.
Right, I was Baptist, so you had to make the decision yourself, but like,
You are making the decision. It was a big deal in my family. It was a big deal. It is a big deal in every family that is calling themselves Catholics. But this kind of Catholic thing.
It's like a different type of dogma, like patriotism and religion. And I guess what's interesting
believe me, they go hand in hand. In Poland, it is you can be sure that when you meet people who are like, I don't know, very right wing, that is a huge possibility that they will be also ultra, not ultra Catholic, but they will be ultra Christian.
Yeah.
Of course, we do have some sort of people like old Slavic religion, like neo-pagan Nazi black metal shit. But it's, you don't want to hear about it.
I know. I've taken so much of your time. I only wanted to take half an hour, and I think I have doubled that, Lukasz. So I will.
It's not a problem.
But I went so many unique and fascinating directions. So thank you so much. And when I share this, I'll make sure to put links to your comics so people can see more about what you do. And I wish you and your family the best. And I hope that this all kind of pans out quickly and easily and painless, hopefully.